Yes. Yes. When you see it laying on the ground. Hi everyone, I'm Jordan Prince, and this is The Moment. In this series, I'm going to spotlight moments in music history that leave a lasting impression with the listener and try to figure out how they did it. And today, I want to talk about this song. Let one go. Wait. That one's actually pretty funny. That's Let One Go from YouTuber Nick Mao, and it's about farts. But that's for another episode. Today, I really want to talk about this song. James Joseph Brown, often referred to as the hardest working man in show business, Mr. Dynamite, the godfather of soul, soul brother number one, is a dancer, a singer, a musician, a songwriter, a band leader. The list goes on and on. He's the central progenitor of funk music and a major figure in 20th century music. He's also really good at checkers, but that fact always just gets left behind. In a career that lasted over 50 years, he influenced the development of many different genres. Brown was one of the very first 10 inductees into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1986. Brown began his journey in Toccoa, Georgia as a gospel singer. He first came to national public attention in the mid-1950s as the lead singer of the Famous Flames, a then-only rhythm and blues vocal group founded by Bobby Byrd. It was either be a rhythm and blues vocal group or a barbecue grill manufacturer. It's a close call. Could have gone either way. With hit ballads like Please, Please, Please and Try Me, Brown made a reputation as a dynamic performer. His career peaked in the 60s with a hit album called Live at the Apollo, featuring tracks like Papa's Got a Brand New Bag, I Got You, I Feel Good, and It's a Man's, Man's, Man's World. This is a man's world! Whose title was actually originally called It's a Man's, 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 During the late 1960s, Brown moved away from the continuum of rhythm and blues styles to a more profoundly Africanized approach to music making, approaching stripped-down interlocking rhythms that ended up being the foundation for the development of funk music. By the early 1970s, Brown had established the funk sound. He had formed the group The JBs and released records like Get Up, I Feel Like Being a Sex Machine, The Payback. He also became noted for songs of social commentary like the 1968 hit Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. Brown continued to perform and write until his death from pneumonia in 2006. Some say it wasn't in fact pneumonia that killed James Brown, but allegedly too much sex machining. Yeah! I'm not a doctor. It's probably true. Brown recorded 17 singles that went number one on the Billboard R&B chart. He also holds the record for most singles listed in the Billboard Hot 100 that didn't reach number one. Like, imagine if that had some kind of award. Congratulations, Mr. Brown. All 25 of your wonderful songs didn't go to number one. Here's a voucher for 25% off at Old Navy. In 2013, James Brown was inducted into the first class of the Rhythm and Blues Music Hall of Fame. He also received honors from many other institutions like the Black Music and Entertainment Walk of Fame and the Songwriters Hall of Fame. He began singing in talent shows as a child, first appearing at Augusta's Lenox Theater in 1944, where he won. While in Augusta, little James Brown performed buck dances for change for troops that would convoy in and out of Camp Gordon at the beginning of World War II because they passed over a bridge right by his aunt's house. Buck dances are kind of like clogging or tap shoe dances. Your shoes are plated to be percussive. During this period, he learned to play the harmonica, the guitar, and the piano. He became inspired to be an entertainer after hearing Caledonia by Louis Jordan and his Timpani Five. And in his teen years, he briefly had a stint as a boxer. Oh, that could have been a very different video. That could have been a totally different job. Also, Lewis and Jordan are my middle name and my first name, so I kind of think James Brown owes me a thank you. Just saying. Brown eventually joined Bobby Bird's group in 1954. The group had evolved from the Gospel Starlighters, an a cappella gospel group, to an R&B group called the Avons. In October of 1958, Brown released the track Try Me, which became the very first of what would become 17 R&B chart-topping hits. By 1960, James Brown was experimenting and multitasking in the studio, including himself, the Famous Flames, or his other group, sometimes known as the James Brown Orchestra or the James Brown Band. That year, the band released the R&B hit Do the Mashed Potatoes under the pseudonym Nat Kendrick and the Swans, due to billing reasons. Of all the names, Nat Kendrick, Brown released his hit song Papa's Got a Brand New Bag in 1965, which earned him his very first Grammy. Let's jump ahead a little bit to 1973. James Brown does the music for a blaxploitation film called Black Caesar, and that is where we find the song The Boss. So you're probably wondering by now, what is the moment of this song? Well, I'm very glad that you asked. It's the opening 11 seconds. In just those first 11 seconds, Brown establishes personality and attitude and control and engagement with the listener, either back then live on stage or even now, some 40 odd years later with me, some dude in a room with headphones. The moment that the music starts, you have this intertwined pair of lovers like the last day of summer break, the bass and the drums, paired together, playing a simple, clear, minimalized groove. Nothing too over the top, the importance being on staying in the groove. He gets your head bobbing from just the first two notes. Now, watching those two lovers from a tree, licking his lips and peering through his binoculars, is our good old friend, the rhythm guitar. He creates the first of two guitar patterns that are to come. For the majority of the song, the rhythm guitar plays the same thing, but partnered with the bass and the drums. It sets this foundation. It's already got your attention. And it's laying this groundwork for anything else to come, the iconic horn section or the vocals. Next, and this is really only 5 or 6 seconds into the song, the second rhythm guitar enters, and it's almost opening a door for Brown's vocals to rip through. The second guitar doesn't steal the show, it doesn't drive the song into a new section, but it plays a separate rhythmic pattern to counterbalance with the first guitar. So you have clean bass, a rhythmic drum beat, and two guitar parts that are sort of dancing around each other, snakes charmed from the basket, if you will. And with that second guitar comes James M.F. and Brown. And he sings the first line of the song. Paid the cost to be the boss. Ah! Paid the cost to be the boss. And in those 11 seconds, so much is established organically. The rhythm, the story, the message, the feeling, the vibe, the groove. It's a classic James Brown moment, and he's got you now. And it's time, in his own words, to get up off that thing! Okay, so first, going back to the 60s. In 1967, Brown's music was coming to be defined as funk music. That year, he released what most critics consider to be the very first funk song, Cold Sweat. It went number one on the R&B chart, and this is important, it was one of the very first songs that included a drum break. By 1969, Brown's vocals frequently took the form of rhythmic declamation. Not quite sung, not quite spoken, only intermittently featuring traces of pitch or melody. This would become a major influence on the future of rapping. Rapping would come to maturity with hip-hop in the coming decades. Brown's style of funk in the 60s was based on interlocking syncopated rhythms. Strutting bass lines, percussive, innovative guitar licks, and syncopated drum parts. As a result, James Brown remains to this day the most sampled recording artist. Brown had clear goals, clear intention. He shaped funk music into something new, something all his own, and he expected perfection out of those that he was paying to play with him. He also needed to be number one, and for a long time, he was. So getting back to the moment, those opening 11 seconds, what do we hear? We hear bass, drums, two rhythm guitars, and vocals. Well, I'm not going to try and replicate this song, The Boss, but I think I will make a short funk tune inspired by James Brown and the Famous Flames. So I'm going to change the setup here. I'll find a couple of old rusty axes to play with, and I'm going to make us a tune. All right, so we have a new setup here. I have a new shirt, so that's something. I'm going to go through GarageBand here. For those just at home with not that much equipment, just one guitar, you can make fully bodied tracks just like this. And that's what I really want to show you in these music playing segments, is that you can be an amateur, you can be a beginner, you can be someone who just loves to make demos at home for themselves. You want to make skeletons of songs. And right here in GarageBand, they have a loop station with many, many drums and many, many bass. Normally I would play the bass guitar. I did a video about that once with Stevie Wonder. I'm going to go through their loop station here and find a drum beat, something funky. So I'm going to go to the genre of disco funk. They don't have pure funk. They don't have pure funk, but they have disco funk. So I'm going to go for that. And I see something already called Throwback Funk Beat 2. I've got the BPM set to 100. 120 felt a little fast. Try and see what it sounds like. Is it what we're looking for? Is it clean? Is it straightforward? 4, 3, 2, 1. Oh, I like that open hi-hat at the end. Yes. And with a great drum beat like that, we need a bass. So again, these are all just preset loops in GarageBand. It's free. Just go in there, find a drum beat that you like, a bass line that you like. I'm looking here again, disco funk, basses. There's one called Crosstown Disco Bass. Why not? Let's just put it in there. They're already pre-recorded, pre-mixed. You don't have to do too much with them. If we think about that drum beat, it's really straightforward. So the bass can move a lot. I think I want quite a melodic bass to keep things funky and groovy. Yes. 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 Okay, things are moving. So I'm going to set up the drums and the bass together here on a track to loop. And then I'm going to create a channel all the way on the right for our first guitar. Remember, we need two guitars and then vocals, and then we have our funk track inspired by James Brown's The Boss. I'll use my Gibson here, and we'll try and make a cool, funky track. Yeah, that's going to be our track. We're going to clean up that second guitar, put it all the way to the left, so we have some tight, pocketed little chords. And the cool little funky doom dap 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 badoo. Put it all together, and then I'm gonna lay down some funny vocals and make a funk track. Let's check out that final product, why don't we?
When you see dog poop on the street, don't pick it up, baby. Put it down. Dog shit.
James Brown was a revolutionary in the world of music. There's no denying his accomplishments, or his accolades, or his seemingly endless contributions to many different genres. But it does not mean that he was perfect in his private life. I mean, wow, like just one swift scroll through this dude's Wikipedia and it's pretty shocking. It's pretty shocking. He did a lot of little bad stuff. The guy did a lot of bad stuff. So much bad stuff. But musically, like in terms of the songs that he wrote, dude was pretty gifted. Is there another song from another artist you think we should cover in this series? Well, just put it in the comments below and funk your way over to that subscribe button and sex machine that notification bell so you don't miss new videos. And thanks for watching.